Hello, good afternoon. Welcome back to Introduction to Philosophy. I haven't made a video for about 2 weeks now. So today in this video, I'm going to talk to you to give you a general overview of the topic for this week, which is theory of knowledge or epistemology. And then in the next video, I will talk to you about a more specific philosopher who does epistemology, which is the French philosopher René Descartes. So anyway, let's start with the first things first. As I said in this video, I'm going to give you an overview of the theory of knowledge or epistemology. theory of knowledge is sometimes also known as epistemology. Now, if you are confused with the word epistemology, actually, you can break it down into its components. So epistemology comes from two Greek words, episteme and logos. Episteme means something like knowledge or science. Logos means a theory or an account. So epistemology could be literally translated as the theory of knowledge, which is why to do epistemology is to do theory of knowledge, and to do theory of knowledge is to do epistemology. So epistemology, theory of knowledge, as the name suggests, is concerned with two main questions. It is mainly concerned with the foundations of knowledge and how we can be secure that we know what we think we know. So there are basically two main questions that epistemology is concerned with. The first question is, how do we know what we claim to know? The second question is how are we justified in claiming to know what we claim to know? Now, the second question is a more complex question than the first one, because the first one deals with the processes by which we come to acquire knowledge about ourselves and the world, whereas the second one isn't really concerned with the processes by which we attain knowledge, but it is concerned with the further question of how, once we come to know something, how can we be certain that we actually know, and are not deluded or deceived in thinking that we know when we actually don't. So, to put it in more philosophical terms, the question would be, how are we justified in or how are we certain in believing that we know something? How are we certain in knowing something? So anyway, in this particular video, I'm just going to touch on the first question, and then in the next video on Descartes, I will touch on the second question, which is how are we justified in claiming to know what we claim to know. So let's start with the first question. How do we know what we claim to know? Another way of posing this question would be to ask, what are the processes by which we come to gain knowledge of things around us and things about ourselves? So generally, we can divide we can list five sources of knowledge. Basically, these five sources, these are five ways by which we come to acquire knowledge about the world. These are five ways in which we come to know things about the world and about ourselves. So let me go through each one of them in turn. So the first one is sensory or perceptual knowledge. Now, as the name suggests, sensory knowledge refers to knowledge of things that we get through our five senses. So, for example, if I look out my window right now and I see a tree with green leaves, I would say that the knowledge that there is a tree with green leaves outside my window is a piece of knowledge that I get through my senses. So it is perceptual knowledge or sensory knowledge. It is obvious that a lot of our knowledge comes to us through our five senses. I hear things directly through my hearing, and so that also counts as perceptual knowledge. I smell things, and that counts as perceptual knowledge too. So we can see that perceptual knowledge is a major source of knowledge about the world. So another source of knowledge is knowledge of mathematical and logical truths. So there are certain, according to many philosophers, there are certain mathematical and logical truths that are so basic and so obvious that we can actually know them without knowing anything about the world at all. So, for example, I can know that 2 plus 2 equals 4 or 2 plus 3 equals 5 without knowing anything about the world at all. Logical truths are the same thing. So, for example, I can know that something cannot be P and not P at the same time. For example, I know that something cannot be red and not red at the same time. Well, actually, it can be. There are things that are red in there are things that they are red in one part and not red in another part. But so to be really specific, what I would say is that it is impossible for one very fine point in space to be red and not red at the same time. Another example, a better example would be something cannot be male and not male at the same time, or something cannot be female and not female at the same time. The idea is that something cannot possess one quality and its opposite at the same time. So that is a basic logical truth that we can know even if we don't know anything about the world. Even if I don't know what it is to be male, I can know that something cannot be male and not male at the same time. Even if I don't know what it is to be male. So another example of number two would be basic truth of geometry. So for example, I can know that a triangle, something that has three sides, must be a triangle. And I can know this, I can form images of triangles in my head and know and recognize something as with three sides as being a triangle, even if no triangles exist in the world. So even if there are no, physical triangles existing in the real world, I can still understand that if something is to be a triangle, it has to have three sides. So the basics of geometry, the basic truths of geometry, also fall under knowledge of mathematical and logical truths. Now, okay, so that's for one and two, and then number three, the third source of knowledge is memory knowledge. So very often we know things by remembering them. So I might remember that there is a tree with green leaves outside my window, even if I'm not standing by my window right now. And I can know this because I remember. So I can recall this from memory. And memory, as we all know, is one very important source of knowledge about the world and about ourselves. And then number four, knowledge from testimony. So a lot of our knowledge, a lot of what we know about the world does not come to us directly through our senses or through our memory. Instead, it comes to us from what other people tell us, or it comes to us from what we read in the books or in magazines, or what we see on television. And this knowledge from testimony is actually also a very important part of how we come to know about the world. So here's one example. I know that Barack Obama is the president of the United States. I've actually never met Obama before. How do I know that? Well, I saw the news when he was elected, and I trust that the news is a reliable source of knowledge about the world. I see him, well, every other day on TV, or I hear about him in the news. And I trust that the news and the TV is a reasonably reliable source of knowledge about the world. So because of that, I know about Barack Obama through the testimony of other people like reporters and journalists and the media in general. And there's a lot of other pieces of knowledge like that that we get from testimony. Because it's impossible for us to see everything there is to see and know everything, and hear everything there is to hear directly. So we have to get knowledge from secondhand sources, from books or media or television. So knowledge from testimony is also an important part of, it's also an important component of our knowledge of the world. The last way in which we can get to know about the world is by inference. So sometimes we get knowledge about the world by combining pieces of knowledge from the previous four sources. So, for example, maybe I'll visit Washington DC tomorrow, And when I'm in DC, I might, I'm standing on a street corner, and I might see this big limo with a, with some Secret Service agents and a motorcade passing me by, and then I look at the limo and I catch a fleeting glimpse of this black man with graying short hair in a suit, and I see and I recognize that to be Barack Obama, but. I think the reason why I can recognize Barack Obama when he passes me by in the in the limo, in the presidential limo, is because I have combined my present perception of the man in front of me with what I've seen in the news. In other words, I have inferred from a combination of sensory knowledge, present sensory knowledge, and knowledge from testimony that this guy standing in front of me that I'm seeing right now is Barack Obama. So knowledge by inference, as we can see, is also a very important source of knowledge about the world. So there are these five sources of knowledge, five ways by which we come to know things about the world. Now, the first two sources, perceptual knowledge and knowledge of mathematical and logical truths, are what we call direct sources of knowledge, because we get information about the world directly through our senses. We get information, we know about mathematical and logical truths directly through using our reasoning processes. There is no, we don't need any kind of intermediary for us to think about basic mathematical and logical truths. We just, we can just know about it immediately through reasoning. But the last three, memory knowledge, knowledge of testimony, and knowledge by inference, are indirect sources of knowledge. Because memory comes to us, memory is parasitic on sensory knowledge. If we don't have the five senses, we won't be able to remember anything, because nothing would have gone into our into our minds in the first place. Knowledge from testimony is also indirect, because it comes to us through other people, secondhand, so to speak. And knowledge for inference is also indirect, because we need to piece together a combination of two or more of these previous sources in order to infer to get a new piece of knowledge by inference. So these last three, memory knowledge, knowledge from testimony, and knowledge by inference, are indirect sources of knowledge. Both the indirect, both the direct sources of knowledge and the indirect sources of knowledge are ways by which we come to acquire knowledge about the world and ourselves. So, in the next video, I will talk about how Descartes tries to undermine all our knowledge by undermining our first two sources of knowledge. The idea is that, he wants to be sure that we really know what we know. But in order to be sure that he has to first destroy all our existing knowledge by casting into doubt anything that that there is even the least bit of uncertainty about. And anyway, in the next video, I'll tell you in more detail how he does that. But for now, I'll stop here. So I'll see you soon. Thank you.